Hi, this is Prashant Dixit from ETM Systems, Bangalore. I'm a lead software engineer over there, working on video communication systems on multiple platforms, including Android. This presentation is actually prepared by a couple of my colleagues, Santosh and Pai, who are not here because of some official work. So I'm going to present it here. So the talk is, the discussion is about how to develop a high-performance, real-time multimedia application on Android. Now, the key challenges involved in these kind of applications, now whether Android SDK or NDK provided APIs meet these performance challenges. Now, if not, what other APIs in Android which we can use to realize these kind of applications? So the talk is mainly concentrated on that. Let's set the agenda for the topic. I hope I don't have to talk much on this section. It's basically just to say why do you have to go Android on embedded devices. Then we'll quickly go into some details on a typical real-time multimedia application. Now, how would the application look? What are the architectural elements? What are the key components in those systems? Then we look at the challenges involved in realizing those kind of applications. Then we'll see how we can design and integrate those kind of applications into Android and its runtime. Finally, I have some proposals to make to Google. I don't know whether Google people are around. to standardize some of the APIs in at least at the NDK layer, because it's really painful to develop real-time multimedia applications with the current set of Android APIs. So let's begin. I'll quickly browse through these slides because it's bread and butter for you. It's actually difficult to define an embedded system in a single statement. I just tried to define it. It's a system dedicated for a particular real-time application. For example, your mobile phone is an embedded system dedicated for a voice call. Actually, it was initially dedicated for a voice call. Now it has become one of application in your mobile. Things like an IFE, clients, streaming servers, desktop, video phones, all fall under this kind of embedded devices. We'll have a glance at the hardware capabilities around with this embedded device. I've just picked one as an example. It's a mobile platform. We have 1.5 gigahertz quad core. I think as I speak, this has even increased. It may be 1.8 gigahertz quad core as of now. So you have a high RAM, external memory, and you have GPUs like Adreno, VESA accelerators. VESA stands for video, imaging, speech, and audio. So usually these kind of processors brought out by TI, Qualcomm, NVIDIA kind of chip vendors comes with accelerators for this processing. They have a codec acceleration for both encoding and decoding. So what I want to say here is the application which, the performance of the application which you are developing with this hardware capabilities should be limited only by the hardware and not by the software stack on top of it. So we should try to extract best out of the hardware platform. So as I can see, we can do a three-way 720p class video conferencing application with this kind of an hardware, so which can come on your mobile handset. So why to restrict to a VGA class peer-to-peer phone? So these are some of the applications which I just discussed. So finally, why Android for embedded systems? There are 100 more reasons. I've just picked few. The biggest is the licensing model. Now Windows is not free, and Android comes for free. It's Apache license. And it's top of Linux, so you have a V4L2, and it's best suited for the devices with screens. So you have a lot of drivers on Linux and a lot of open source community developing those kind of drivers. More importantly, you have access to thousands of apps on Android market. If you access of thousands of apps from Android market, if you use Android on this kind of device. I'll give you an example. Now, if you have a room conferencing system where you have it on Android, and you install an RDP application on it. Now, in a Room video conferencing system, I can connect to my laptop and stream the presentation or any content from my laptop to the remote parties existing in the conference. I can name 100 such use cases with Android and Android apps on these embedded systems. So this is one of the key benefits of having Android in such kind of embedded systems in enterprise world. There are more reasons. I don't have to talk much on that. So let's quickly move on to real-time multimedia system. Before going into the actual architecture of the system, we'll just define what a real-time system means. It's pretty simple. So basically, a real-time system has an input, a stream of input coming in at a rate, at an input rate, and the system has to process it, produce an output with the same input rate. Now, if it doesn't match, then there's no point of generating those outputs. It's useless. For example, if you have an input stream coming in at 720p, 30 frames per second, and if you're not processing it and displaying it or screen, then you'll introduce build-up latency, and the video which will be displayed is of useless. So real-time system, the main concentration here is the time at which your processing element takes. So it has to be very fast. It has to be beyond input rate. I've just picked video conferencing as an example because it's close to my heart. I work for video conferencing systems. This is architectural, nothing to do with Android, just saying what, how would a video conferencing application would look. You have GUI and you have a call control state machine with signaling stacks and a core media engine. Now, if I dissect core media engine here, these are some of the architectural blocks inside the core media engine for a typical video conferencing application. It's a very simple architecture which I've picked for a peer-to-peer kind of a system. So you capture it from camera, encode, packetize, and send it over network. You receive from network, depacketize, decode, and display. Very simple. Now, these are the four key components or modules in the system which are of interest for us, which will define the performance of your video conferencing system. We'll look at the challenges involved in this system. Low latency. So latency which I'm talking about is not the touch or user latency. The latency is a media latency. It's end-to-end or glass-to-glass video latency. For a typical communication, it should be less than 200 milliseconds. Beyond 200 milliseconds of latency would mean a not so good communication system. I'm not just talking about communication. Even a broadcast streaming client, a streaming client which will decode and display a live football match, you will want to see the match with as good experience as a live stream would do. You don't want a 5-second delay in video. Right. So high performance, it's basically the whatever platform offers. Now, if platform offers 1080p three-way, then I should be able to get 1080p three-way in my application. I should not be restricted by software limitation. That doesn't mean that I have to load my system 100%, because if my system loads at 100%, I would drain the battery very fast. So I should load my system as much as required. And quality of service. It depends on the application which I'm talking about. If I pick video conferencing again here, it would mean the AV synchronization or the packet loss handling, error recovery, and error resilience. So there are certain encoder and decoder level configurations which will help in achieving these things. So I should be able to use those configurations and to get a better quality of service for my application. This challenge comes because of Android and because of operating systems like Android, because you have other applications running on your systems. So your application should coexist with this with other applications. So I should not hog a driver, or I should not hog audio capture by opening an ALSA channel and not letting other applications to open any ALSA channels. So my application should coexist with other applications. More importantly, portability. So with Android changing versions almost every year, so your application should be portable from one flavor of Android to another flavor of Android. So these are a set of challenges in developing a real-time multimedia applications. So let's see how we can design and integrate a real-time multimedia applications with these challenges. This diagram you must have seen some 1,000 times. So if you look at carefully here, there are three sets of interfaces this diagram depicts. The first one is interface between kernel and Android native framework. So this will have kernel APIs, the driver APIs. For example, ALSA, V4L2, OSS, frame buffer, or accelerator, OpenGL. So those kinds of APIs are exposed here. Now, can I develop a multimedia application with those kinds of APIs? Of course, yes, why not? I've been doing that from ages. All our multimedia applications were coming on Linux, so I can do that on Android as well. But what's the problem with developing such applications on Linux, with Linux APIs on Android? The problem is with coexistence. Now, if I open an ALSA channel, ALSA capture channel, Android Flinger, Audio Flinger will not be allowed to open one more ALSA channel. Or if I hog a V4L2 display driver or frame buffer driver, then Android will not get a frame buffer access. So coexistence will become a problem. Performance, definitely we can meet. There's no overhead. There's no stack overhead. It's directly talking to drivers. But coexistence with other applications will become a problem. So I cannot use Linux APIs to develop such kind of an application. The other set of interface is the most talked about in DroidCon conferences, the interface which Android provides to Java developers, the Java APIs which Android provides. Android does provide media APIs like media player, media recorder, camera. Yes, those kinds of APIs are provided. But if you look deep into those APIs, now if I take media player as an example, will I be able to realize all kinds of applications using media player? No, because as an example, I won't be able to have access for independent decode. Now, decoder output is not accessible, and I won't be able to do a transcode application using media player APIs. Now, to take camera as an example, will I be able to use camera independently? Yes, I can, but what about the performance? Now, camera at Java layer has to provide you contiguous virtual address for the Java users. Now, the underlying platform might not have that. Underlying platform might be using a Tyler memory for camera buffers. So Android has to convert the Tyler memory into virtual address space. There may be a memcopy involved in this process. So for applications which are a lower resolution, which are not processor intensive, if I want to do a mere SIF or a VGA class device, yes, this is possible with the current set of hardware we have. I can do memcopy, I can do anything on 1.5 gigahertz quad core. But if I'm talking about 1080p 30, 1080p 60, no. So these APIs cannot be used for such high performance requirements. And even some of the use cases cannot be even realized. As I said, transcoding cannot be even realized with Java APIs provided in Android. So to conclude, some of the required functionality is not exposed, and expected performance cannot be reached. So there's a third set of interface, which is Android Native Framework interface. Now, this covers NDK provided APIs as well as the Android Native Framework APIs, which are not part of NDK. Now, here, if I'm talking about camera, now the camera here would directly connect to camera service, and there is no, and I can get a direct hardware address from the camera service, so there's no memory conversion which is happening here. Now, if I take display as an example, like I'll get access to the surface or native window, and I can play around with native window. Now, if I take decoder, encoder, so I'll get all kind of access to these modules in this native layer. As well as, since I'm not touching the Android framework, and I'm using Android framework as is, I will still be coexisting with other applications. So if I use a IOMX decoder, any other media player can still be using a media player Java API and can still run along with my application. So because the Java media player application underlying will still use IOMX based video decoding. So the coexistence will not be a problem. Performance will not be a problem. I can, I'll talk more on the performance aspect in the next slide. So this is the best place where we can develop the real-time multimedia application. So this was a slide which I just showed you. And these are the four elements, key elements, where we will need to find the APIs. The right set of APIs in Android to realize those. So let's see what can be used for each of them. For capture, now for audio capture, you have OpenSLES. NDK has stable OpenSLES APIs from Gingerbread onwards, if I'm not mistaken. So definitely one can use OpenSLES APIs for audio capture, not a problem. But OpenSLES underlying will still use Audio Flinger and Audio Record for its operation. That means that there is a IPC which is happening between Flinger and your application, which will still introduce some amount of latency. Now, we have seen that with OpenSLES, we can achieve sub 180 millisecond of end-to-end latency for capture and playout. But if an application is looking for even lesser, I would say if application is looking for a 60 millisecond kind of end-to-end latency, then OpenSLES is not the right approach. We can go with TinyAlsa. Now, TinyAlsa is not a stable API in NDK as of now. But with the low latency requirement, we can still use TinyAlsa for your application development. Now, if for any normal use case, OpenSLES will suit your requirement, not a problem. For video capture, as I said, there is a native camera interface. Again, it's not a stable interface, stable API from NDK till as of now. It directly communicates to camera service, and you can access, you can get frame by frame access. You'll get a metadata access, which can be fed to encoder. So for video capture, camera native camera interface is the best suited API. When come to display and playout, again, audio playout is OpenSLES, no need to talk about. Then display, since you need to decode in native layer and you need to provide surfaces to the decoder, you will have to convert the surface which you obtain from Java to native window and then provide those surfaces to the decoders or the encoder. So display, you can use surfaces and convert it to native window. And surface, you can obtain either by texture view or a surface view. I hope you guys are aware of the difference between texture view and surface view.
One question.
Sure.
Regarding the surface.
Yes. Yes, yes. So surface texture is not an
NDK
API.
Can you repeat the question once? Or what was
What he says is surface texture is not an NDK API, and it's a native Android framework API, and we'll not be able to use it with NDK. I hope that that's the question.
Yeah, the same goes for client buffer and all the other.
Yes, yes. It, the same goes for even camera, if I talk about. So that's why I have some recommendations for Google. So if you want to get high performance on Android, with high performance on Android, you'll have to use this kind of APIs. Now, since it's not available in NDK, we'll have to go with a baseboard build approach. So you cannot use NDK for your building this kind of applications. Vendors like TI or Qualcomm will upload baseboard to websites, so it's easily downloadable. So you can build your application on top of this baseboards, not a problem. Yeah, I was talking about surface view and texture view. So surface view is something which will provide you a surface, and it will directly connect to the hardware hardware video windows if available. Now, on for example, if on a TIO map platform, there are three hardware video windows available. Now, if an application opens a surface view, then it will directly get linked to the hardware video window. So the access will be faster, and it will be with YOV. When it comes to texture view, now texture view will provide you a surface, and it will get routed through OpenGL interface. So it will be graphics, so there will be an RGB to YOV conversion which is happening. But all this is accelerated, so you don't have to worry about it. But if possible, you can use surface view. But if you need more animations in your applications like Z-order or transparency or some kind of an animations which you would like to have it on video windows, go for texture view. Otherwise, if it's a plain video which you want to display, go for surface view because it's more optimized because it has a hardware window. In either case, you'll have to convert it, you have to get a surface handle from the surface view or texture view, pass it to the native layer, get a native window handle, and perform all your operations set using native window handle. Encode. There are no standard APIs available in Android for video encoding. So you'll have to use IOMX APIs. Now, IOMX APIs have been pretty much stable from 4.0 onwards. So we have not seen much of a difference in these APIs from 4.0 onwards. And there is one more advantage in using IOMX interface is if you want to provide the camera buffer to encode, since as you all know, all this is running in different processes. Encoder is running in different process, camera client is running in a different process. Now, if you want to provide buffers, share buffers from capture to encode, you can't share it directly. So what these chip vendors who ports the Android onto their platform does is they do some kind of a workaround for this method. So they expose metadata, something called as metadata from capture. From camera client exposes the metadata, and you pass the metadata to encoder, which is a 12-byte object. Just pass that metadata to encoder, and encoder knows which hardware buffer the camera is using. So with this, you should be able. With this, there is no overhead of passing buffers from camera to encode. Now decode. Decode, you have OpenMax AL API standardized with NDK, I'm not sure, 8.E onwards or something. It's, but OpenMax AL decode has certain limitations. It can only decode MPEG-2 content, and you will not be able to, if you have a H.264 RTP stream coming in, now you have to create an MPEG-2 TS stream and provide that to OpenMax AL decoder, and then use it. And there are certain APIs and configurations which are missing from this OpenMax AL decoding. For example, if you are aware of video decoding display order. Now, display order is something which is basically the frame. If display order is equal to decode order, it's the decoder will provide frames to display. If it's not equal to decode order, then decoder can hold back certain frames and we can provide those frames to display at a later point in time. That means there is a delay incurred in these systems. So these kind of configurations, the display order configurations, are not available with OpenMax AL decode. So if you are looking for a low latency system, then no, you cannot use OpenMax AL for your decoding purpose. But if you're OK with the initial 15 buffers or how much, well, whatever the decoder takes that much delay, then you can definitely use OpenMaxCL decoding for your purpose. For low latency applications, you should still go through IOMX. Now, one other advantage using IOMX is you can call all codec APIs using IOMX. So whatever codec exposes, the hardware exposes, whatever the hardware capability is, you can all of those can be realized using IOMX APIs, IOMX codec APIs. So that's the best way of for going for encoding and decoding. So let's see whether we meet the challenges which I've spoken about earlier. Low latency, yes. Audio, you can go with OpenSLES if it's sub 200 millisecond, or Tiny ALSA if it's around sub 80 millisecond. For video, anyway, decoder, we have configurations for display order, so low latency is met there. For capture and camera, there is no additional overhead of copying or anything, so there is a frame. Low latency is met over there. High performance, yes, there is no stack overhead. You're accessing the codecs directly, you're accessing camera directly, there's no mem copy involved anywhere in your system. So definitely performance can be met using these APIs. Low system load, yes, of course. Quality of service, as I said, using IOMX, you can control codec parameters much easier than other APIs, because other APIs won't even expose those kind of configurations. So quality of service can be easily achieved with these APIs. Coexistence, yes, because I'm not touching Android framework. I'm still building on top of Android framework. So you should still be able to run other multimedia applications along with your application. There should not be any problem. Portability. So this will be the key aspect. Since I'm using APIs which are not yet stable in NDK, not yet exposed using SDK, portability might be a question, but whatever we have seen till date, it's not an issue. You should be able to port your application within a couple of days. Because interfaces like IOMX or camera client or OpenSLES is anyway NDK standard, are the interfaces which are not going to change in from version to version in near future. So portability, although it is not directly cross-compile or directly runnable, it's just have to make a finer tweak between API calls and you should be able to port it very easily. So now you have developed your application using these APIs. Now just have to integrate that into Android. So you have your native C++ APIs from your module. I think this slide you must have already been known. So you create a Java API class, you have a JNA layer and a Java service. With AIDL, with Android Interface Definition Language, you communicate with your Java application. And with JNA, you communicate with your native layer. One key aspect here is I'm splitting the Java service and the GUI into two separate processes. There are multiple advantages with this approach. First one is there can be multiple Java applications which can connect to your service. So that's not a problem with this approach. Second one is your code might be buggy and your GUI might crash. Now, if you link to the same process, even your media service would crash. So keeping it separate will also mean easy to handle this crash situations. So there are some broadcast receivers and broadcast senders here. You can start your process on boot. If you are a video, if you have developed a video communication VCS, video communication system, now you can start your service on boot, listen for signaling events. Whenever there's an incoming call from a remote party, you can send a broadcast event to the Java application. Whoever listens for broadcast event would show you a incoming call message. So this is a typical application, a native application integration into Android. So finally, I have some proposals for API standardization. camera APIs can be standardized at NDK. Because camera APIs are available in SDK, it's actually available, camera clients available in native framework, but those are not made stable as of now. So it will really help the multimedia system application developers if those kinds of APIs are standardized. Now, video display. There are certain APIs, native window APIs, which are standardized, like lock, unlock, and post. And certain APIs are standardized, but that's not sufficient. Lock and unlock are something which can be used for a ping pong kind of an application. But if you want to maintain multiple buffers, you need QDQ APIs to be standardized or made stable. Encode, as I said, there's nothing available. So it's always better to have an independent video encode API in NDK. Decode, yes, we have OpenMax AL decode, which has been recently introduced, but there with certain limitations. So just remove those limitations, provide configurations, that's it. Audio capture and playout, there's nothing to be done, very minor enhancements to be made. Minor enhancements, I meant, if you are working with acoustic echo cancellation, you would be aware of under and over end situations for ALSA. So these kinds of notifications of underrun and overrun is not available as of now in OpenSLES framework. So, and timestamps. So such minor tweaks has to be made in OpenSLES APIs. That's it. So if you have any questions, I'm open.